Aaron Hernandez accused of killing semi-pro football player Odin Lloyd, blasting him in the chest, in the side, and in the back. Hours after the cops slapped the cuffs on him this morning and walked him from his mansion, the Pats announced Hernandez is off our team.
The verdict unanimous. The sentence automatic. Life without parole in state prison. The
jury deliberated roughly 40 hours and found him not guilty of the most serious charges against him. Many charges lodged against him by prosecutors who said he was responsible for the deaths of two men who were shot to death.
Now, just 5 days later, stunning news that the former New England Patriots star is dead. Aaron Hernandez was discovered hanged in his cell at the Sousa Baranowski Correctional Center just after 3 a.m.
What a story. A stunning fall from grace for former New England Patriots star Aaron Hernandez. The former tight end once played in a Super Bowl alongside Tom Brady, raked in a $41 million contract when he was drafted by the Patriots. But he was charged and convicted of first-degree murder soon after, and then, tragically, took his own life in prison last year. So now a new book by his lawyer depicting the turmoil in Hernandez's final year. Here now is Jose Baez, author of Unnecessary Roughness, Inside the Trial and Final Days of Aaron Hernandez. Jose, good to have you here.
Thank you.
You're well known, obviously, for representing Casey Anthony, who a lot of people believed was guilty. A lot of people believe that Aaron Hernandez is guilty in the death of Odin Lloyd. We have video here of his mother weeping and holding his bloody shirt. The car that was rented, that was brought there, was rented by Aaron Hernandez. He was at the scene. Why do you believe he didn't do it?
Well, because three people identified him as being someplace else, and three other independent witnesses identified the person that was actually in the car as having long hair with cornrows. That's not Aaron Hernandez. I think the evidence was overwhelming that he was innocent, and that's why the jury acquitted him. So, and just to clear it up, I didn't represent him in the first case.
Right.
I represented him in the one.
Acquittal was in the second case.
Correct.
Of the two murders. I'm talking about the first case and the death of Odin Lloyd, which he was convicted for and sent to prison for the rest of his life.
Yes, I have a reasonable doubt that he was guilty on that case because I think, well, what a lot of people don't know is that he was prosecuted under what's called the joint venture theory, which means the prosecutor doesn't know who pulled the trigger. And there were three individuals that were there. Four men went in, three came out. The other two had extensive criminal records. And based on what I've seen, I thought that there was a reasonable doubt in that case. Now, I didn't represent him there, so I'm not as intimately and involved with that case. So that's all I can say is that I have a reasonable doubt that he committed that. I know he didn't commit the second case.
Let me ask you this. You know, he's a complicated person, obviously enormously talented on the football field, but also was known as a troubled guy with a lot of issues. He was picked very low in the draft, and some people believe that it was because of that, because people didn't necessarily want to take him on. But you have a soft spot for him based on your relationship with him in prison.
I do. I think Aaron was somebody that's completely misunderstood, and that's what my book is really a different view of him. We know the storyline. The storyline's been told a million times. What this book is it shows a different perspective of him. I got to know him very well, not only by being with him, but by also reading thousands and thousands of text messages. He was the type of person that couldn't say no to people if someone needed something or wanted something. He was a kind individual, he was a big kid, a big goofy kid. Nothing like the gangster thug that people try to portray him as, or ultimately did portray him as. Can't tell a book by its cover. And this cover was pretty hard.
It's complicated. You have a lawsuit against the NFL on behalf of his daughter. Why? What are you accusing them of?
This is a lawsuit for the loss of consortium for his daughter. This still stems from the issue of CTE, for which the NFL deliberately withheld from its players the information that they had that shows that tackle football and head injuries, repeated head injuries, caused this severe brain damage, which is the direct link to suicide, for which he died.
So, and no link to his violence, to the initial murder, the first murder. You don't think he murdered because of CTE?
I don't, because I have that reasonable doubt. But my knowledge, and I say this with a disclaimer, my knowledge on that case is limited. So all I can say is, based on looking at the case, You know, I'm a lawyer, and I look at it from a certain perspective. And the perspective that I see it in is, even if the prosecutor can't even tell you that he pulled the trigger. So you have to have some doubt there. His overt acts are completely explainable, for which he was convicted, because of evidence that didn't come in that case. Yeah. He was being hunted by a drug dealer at that time, which is why he carried a gun everywhere he went, which is why he had these people around him all the time. And that's what this book, the book does. It kind of puts it into perspective, how one case led to the other and how he ultimately ended up where
he was. Interesting title, Unnecessary Roughness, which can apply to a lot of angles of this story, to be sure. Jose Baez, it's a very interesting story, and I thank you for being here tonight.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.